the focus of today's war strategy, the great gathering of the nations. And the scripture will be Genesis chapter 49, verses 1 and verses 8 through 12, and Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 through 16. And it begins, "And Jacob called unto his sons and said, Gather yourselves together, that I may tell you that which shall befall you in the last days. Judah, thou art he whom thy brethren shall praise. Thy hand shall be in the neck of thine enemies. Thy father's children shall bow down before thee. Judah is a lion's whelp. From the prey, my son, thou art gone up. He stooped down, and he couched as a lion, and as an old lion, who shall rouse him up? The sceptre shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the gathering of the people be, binding his fowl unto the vine, and his donkey's colt unto the choice vine. He washed his garments in wine, and his clothes in the blood of grapes. His eyes shall be red with wine, and his teeth white with milk." Revelation 19. "And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, and clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords." The strategy. Jacob was your first prophet unto the nation of Israel, consisting of 12 men. From the very beginning, you had Jacob prophesy the end times of what the nation of Israel will become just shortly before your arrival. Judah, it was prophesied that they shall lead the way in all that you have ordained to be done in Israel, and this tribe shall be the principal tribe that shall be praised among the people in the latter days. The scepter shall not depart from Judah. When the 12 tribes of Israel were exiled to Assyria and Babylon, it was the tribe of Judah that you decreed would return to prepare the way of your first advent as a lamb. After Judah was exiled from the land by the Roman Empire, you called them back into the land again in 1948 in preparation of your second advent as a lion, and not as a lamb. You have decreed that Judah shall be as fierce as a lion in the last days, and shall not be removed, even when the enemy seeks to dislodge them. They shall rule and establish a firm government, and they shall occupy the land until you, O Lord, which is Shiloh, our Messiah, comes. The vital and most significant sign of your return that you have marked in this scripture prophesied by Jacob to be the two major turnkey events that we must all bear in mind, Father, is the following. The kingdom of Judah, not the kingdom of Israel, for they have never returned from captivity, but it has been Judah that has been prophesied to occupy the land, shall be established as a nation with a firm government in the latter days. And so we have seen your hand establish this right before our eyes. And today, the kingdom of Judah, not Israel, for they were of the northern kingdom, sits in authority and as lawgivers in the Middle East. And a second point, Father, that you told us shall be the sign of your second advent is that you shall literally gather the nations, the people, the country of around the world to Judah in preparation of your visitation, as Jacob has prophesied in the scripture and as it is written in many other places in the Valley of Decision, Jehoshaphat. When you first came down from heaven, you were a gentle lamb, prepared to be the humble, meek, quiet, sacrificial offering for the sins of the world. Redemption has been accomplished for all of mankind, but only a few received it. Now, as prophesied by Jacob, you shall not return as a lamb, not as it was in the former day to redeem the world, but this time you shall return as a fierce lion to judge and to tread upon the winepress of your wrath, as the wicked shall be a sacrifice to over 6,000 years of rebellion. You shall be a great terror to the wicked upon your day of return, known as the day of the Lord. But the hope of those who love you will be evident to all in their hearts. My prophetic dream received on July 2016. Before we go into the prayer strategy for this, I want to share a prophetic dream that the Lord has given me that I did not want to release until he gave me a confirmation on the timing in which it should be spoken to you all. And so, in receiving this strategy from the Lord in regards to the prophecy spoken by Jacob, it ties in and serves as a confirmation to what the Lord has showed me. And like I said before, it is a brief dream, but a very significant one. So as I went to sleep, I found myself waking up in a dream and in a place. I was in a metropolitan area, probably like New York City, Manhattan. Of all places, Manhattan. There's skyscrapers everywhere. People, it was during the daytime, and there's many people in every which direction. And immediately as I appeared into this dream, I noticed that there was great panic in the air, and I myself actually had panic building up inside of me, because I watched as people were running from something. They were all running with great fear and terror in their eyes. And I looked in a direction in which the people were running from. And right in front of me, I saw Jesus. But the thing is that Jesus was not the height of an average man, but he was as tall as the Empire State Building, maybe even taller. He was huge. And he was dressed in a white robe and had a crown on his head. But when you look at his face was not the face of love and joy that you would normally see in the way that they portray Jesus today, is that the look on his face was a face of wrath. And what he began to do is that he began to move through the cities and began to start taking down the skyscrapers. I mean demolishing. He was destroying everything that was standing up. He was very wrathful at the time, and people was running in terror and great fear because of what Jesus was doing. And he, like I said before, he was huge. He was as high as the Empire State Building, and I knew it was him, and his wrath was being expressed upon the rebellious nations, upon the rebellious city, the wicked city. And he was destroying the city. He was taking the city down. And so in fear, I began to run too, because I woke up to find myself in that dream, and that was the place that I was located in, is watching the demolition taking place. And so I began to run, and as I ran from Jesus because I was afraid, immediately the Lord came to me, not the huge Empire State level Jesus, but in my spirit, like the Holy Spirit. Jesus came in the form of a Holy Spirit, and he spoke to me like in a spirit language, and in a language that I understood only in the spirit, but not in the vocal words of man. And he pretty much told me in the spirit that peace must be still upon me. His wrath was not upon me. I had nothing to fear. And the moment that the Holy Spirit came And I saw the Holy Spirit come upon me in the form of Jesus, spoke these words to me and say that I have nothing to fear, but the wrath was not for me. I immediately lost the fear and became a person of calm. Like, my calmness and peace and sound mindedness returned instantly. And then I stopped running and I was actually joyful and glad. But then there's other people who was terrified and they were running. And then Jesus spoke to me in spirit. He says that those who are in me have nothing to fear. The only way that they shall escape my wrath is if they repent. And so immediately there was this guy. And I still remember, you know, what he looked like. He was stocky built. I would say about 5'10", African-American guy. And he was terrified. And so immediately I reached out to him and I told him, hey, hold on. And I began to preach to him. I preached the gospel to him and I told him that what he needed to do to avoid the wrath of God, to avoid the wrath of Jesus Christ that was happening right now. And then I told him that he needed to receive Jesus Christ in his heart and to repent of his sins and declare that Jesus Christ is Lord. And so right there, as I evangelized to him and preached to him, he received Jesus in his heart. And I mean, the moment that he received Jesus into his heart, his whole emotional demeanor changed. He went from being a man of fear to a man with great joy and peace, and he began to smile. And then I woke up from the dream. And so now, having receiving this prayer strategy and seeing where we are today and understanding what the second advent of our Lord will be like, it is important that I put the word out there that when Jesus returns back the second time, is that he's not going to return back as the gentle lamb that we knew of in the beginning of the New Testament. But this time he's coming as a king, right? He's coming to judge. He's already established a plan of salvation. He's already became the sacrificial lamb to take away the sins of the world. He's already done that. He redeemed mankind, but it's up to mankind to receive that salvation. And so when the Lord put himself on that cross, that is the chance and that is the opportunity for people to be spared and saved from the wrath to come. And so the wrath that does not end only here in this earth, but continues on forever and ever in a lake of fire. And so that right there was their ticket to avoid the wrath to come. So now when Jesus comes, he won't come to try to re-preach the gospel, to re-walk the path of salvation which he already established in the past long ago, 2,000 years ago. He's not going to do that because he's already finished his job. He accomplished the plan of salvation. So now when the Lord returns, he shall return to judge and to rule with a rod of iron. We are going to see Jesus in his kingly form, a completely different Jesus than what we've been reading about in the scriptures before. I mean, he would still be the same person, but we are about to see the other side of him that many have never seen before. And what we're going to see is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords taking his rule. And he shall come and tread upon the winepress of his fury, the winepress of the wrath of God. And this is what we can expect to see, is that many shall be judged and many shall be pressed and many shall be sacrificed, you know, be the sacrificial offering for the sins of 10,000 of 6,000 years that has plagued the earth because of Satan. And so this is going to be a time of judgment and we must be ready. If you are in Jesus Christ, you have nothing to fear, as a dream has entailed. And that immediately our first instincts is to have fear. But when we do have fear, the Holy Spirit will come and minister to us. So this way that fear will not overtake us. And when we allow the Holy Spirit to minister to us, which means we must have the Holy Spirit living in us, then we shall be living in the peace of God. And when we're living in the peace of God, we can go out there and do the kingdom work that we're called to do. And that is to seek and save the lost. In the same way that I was able to seek and save the loss of one soul and take him out of that position to where he was under God's wrath, to under God's grace. Let us pray. Father, I thank you so much for today's war strategy. I thank you so much, Father, for speaking to the hearts of your people this day. For indeed, O God, you said that you tell the end from the beginning, and you have been faithful to your word, Father, down to the letter, down to the T. Because, Father, right here, Jacob was the first prophet who prophesied to the land of Israel, to the nation of Israel, because Israel was made up of 12 tribes, which is the 12 sons that was with him, O God. And he prophesied to his 12 sons. So that make him the very first prophet. And from the very foundation of the prophecy, which was established in the nation of Israel, it was already established what their end will become. And we know, Father, that as we go through the scriptures and we learn about the different tribes and how Jacob spoke at the latter end, we see that many of the tribes, all of the tribes has fallen away with the exception of two, O God. And that is the tribe of Joseph that you have blessed mightily, O God. And then there is the tribe of Judah who continues to stand with you, Father, who continues to stand in you this very day. Regardless, Father, of what the people of what the Jewish people are right now, regardless of what their status are, Father, or how they have come into being people of religious minds, of God. We're looking at the overall picture, the redemptive plan of what you have established in your covenant, Father, with Judah. And so today, Father, Judah still stands today. We'll continue to occupy until you return. We thank you so much, Father, for the two turnkey events that we need to be mindful of, oh God. In which the first turnkey event, Father, is that you shall establish the kingdom of Judah, not the kingdom of Israel, God, for they were of the northern kingdom and have never returned back from their captivity, but that you will establish the kingdom of Judah in the land in the latter days. And we see the kingdom of Judah standing at this very hour, and that they shall be a firm government, O God. And that is the first turnkey event. It has been accomplished. Now, the second turnkey event, O God, is that when you are prepared to open up the sky, O God, for the windows of heaven, for the doors of heaven to open, and you manifest, when the time for that moment comes, Father, for you to arrive and make yourself known, you will first gather the nations into the valley of decision, O God, Jehoshaphat, for this would be the place, O God, in which you shall judge the nations, O Lord. So when we begin to see the troops around the world begin to move out from their habitation and begin to position themselves around the kingdom of Judah and begin to make their way to the kingdom of Judah, then we know, O God, that you are orchestrating this now, because now is the time for you to show up. Now is the time for you to return, O God. And so when we begin to see this happen, this is the time where we must truly look up and know that our redemption draweth nigh, because you are gathering the people together for the purpose, O God, for your judgment, to for your wrath and your judgment to be established, and for the kingdom of God to be established upon the earth forever. And so we thank you so much, Father, for giving us this revelation, this knowledge, this insight. And that we thank you so much, Father, for letting us know that when you do begin to manifest yourself, when you do begin to appear on the world stage, O God, that there's going to be much turbulence, O God, much turmoil, much destruction, much wave of change, O God, and such calamities and upheavals that's going to take place, because this is the time of your judgment to judge the earth and to render unto the earth and all its inhabitants what they have reaped in their sowing of sin. And so we pray, Father, that you would just prepare our minds for this time, prepare our hearts for this time, Father. If there's anything that is not of you right now, O God, that is residing in us, O God, that can lead to us being judged, we pray that you will forgive us. We pray that you will take it away from us, and we plead the blood of Jesus upon those areas, Father, of every breach, of every idol that we have established in our hearts right now, O God. We pray, Father, that you would destroy the idols, O God. Remove and dislodge the idols right now in Jesus' name. We pray, Father, that we shall not hold on to any idolatry, O God. And that we will put nothing before you, Father. Because we know, Father, that any idol, Father, that resides in our heart, Father, is an opening for the enemy to exploit. And if the enemy can exploit it, it can cause us to fall into judgment. So we pray that you will have mercy on us, O God. We pray that your grace will continue to fall upon us, O God. And that you will keep us, Father, to walking in the straight and narrow. The straight and narrow, Father, is to walk in a pure and perfect relationship with you the best way that we can. We love you, Lord. And we thank you so much, Father, for releasing this vital war strategy, O God. And so we thank you so much, Father, for the reminder for the people that is listening to this, that the two major turnkey events, O God, first, the kingdom of Judah shall be established in the end times, and that has been accomplished. The next turnkey event is that the troops and nations shall begin to move out of their habitation and begin to gather around the kingdom of Judah in preparation, Father. Truly, they think it would be for the destruction of Israel, but it is not. For they shall be gathered to you, O God, for it is time for the nations to be judged. We love you, Lord, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We'd all been ready. feed off.